Thank you. would be great.
I'll do it.
Yep.
I'll just mark it down.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I got that.
They served one.
Today is Thursday. I don't have any hair. You say I'm a college student.
You know, worship in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. A few announcements. Unfortunately, the family of Kathy Blair, Gerald Hubling, and Jordan Blair, they are ill today, so they will not be joining as new members today. They are still planning to join. Because of that, there are a few changes to the service, and so just follow along on the screen when we get to the Apostles' Creed and everything else. So prayers for quick recovery for the Blair and Hubling family. A reminder that today at about 11 or before, we're going to head down to the Richards family's house. If you need an address, let me know. If you have a paintbrush you want to grab, you can do that. We are going to help them paint their garage and do some other projects. For those who don't know, Mark has been doing increasingly poorly, unfortunately. And because of that, they are looking to move to a one-level house. And so they're looking to move closer to Worthington so she can check in on him more easily. So if anyone does want to join us for painting today, we'll have cars go and come back at various times so we can fit people's schedules. So come talk to me if you haven't talked to someone already about that. I'm going to be in a quick stewardship meeting, and then I will follow down at about 11. So a reminder, tomorrow the office is closed. 7 a.m. Bible study is back on Tuesday morning. Also on Tuesday, we start Grief Share at 2 o'clock. Thank you to Mary Ingenthon for teaching that class. It's such an important resource for our community. And so if you know someone who might benefit from Grief Share, please encourage them to come. If they don't start this week, they can start at any time, and they can come whenever they can. So thank you to Mary, and please share the word that we are doing that class once again. On Wednesday, we continue with Wednesday night worship at 6. We are doing the I Will Celebrate book. It is communion and worship. And then also, choir starts this week. So 6:30, choir begins. If you have any questions about choir, please talk to Eric Parrish, our choir director. Thursday at 10:15 is the Sunshine Service. So a reminder, Thursday at 10:15 for the Sunshine Service. And then on Saturday, the 7th, from 12 to 3, there is a gathering in honor and memory of Sandra Marsh at the Eagles. So Saturday the 7th from 12 to 3 at the Eagles for Sandra Marsh. A couple of quick more things. Next Sunday is God's Work Our Hands Sunday. So don't forget to wear a Thrivent shirt or a yellow God's Work Our Hands shirt. If you do not have a Thrivent shirt, we have lots. And so feel free to help yourself to several. They're downstairs. So join us for that. There are projects for all ages, all abilities. We're going to be doing a mailing for Love, Inc. We're going to be doing some jars of Bible verses for our shut-ins. We're going to be working on visitor bags, helping put together the coat closet again. After the rummage sale, everything got moved, and so we're going to put the coat closet back together and get that set up for the year. We're going to do a furniture delivery for Love, Inc., help clean chairs, help clean pews, all sorts of projects next Sunday. So please come. You can wear your work clothes to worship and be ready for some good time of service. And then afterwards, there will be a meal provided. A special word of thanks to Jay and Kathy Myers for helping provide Thrivent cards for the efforts, and for our stewardship team for planning the whole thing, Linda Negebauer, Aaron Makla, and Becca McGackey, and then, of course, Sandy Papama for making the meal. Stewardship, did I forget anything? Nope. Last but not least, Rolf Malberg wanted to be sure that people knew that the Every Meal food distributions will start on September 19th. We have a few weeks of delays. September 19th, a special word of thanks to Rolf Malberg for now being the new leader for that. So thanks to Rolf. Are there any other announcements? With that, please stand and continue with the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
We continue with our gathering song, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Let us pray. O God, our strength, without you we are weak and wayward creatures. Protect us from all dangers that attack us from the outside, and cleanse us from all evil that arises from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. The first reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 1 through 2 and 6 through 9. The Israelites believed the law was a divine gift that provided guidelines for living out the covenant. Moses commands the people to obey the law and to neither add to nor subtract from it. The Israelites are also to teach the law to their children and their children's children. Here begins the reading. So now, Israel, give heed to the statutes and ordinances that I am teaching you to observe, so that you may live to enter and occupy the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, is giving you. You must neither add anything to what I command you, nor take away anything from it, but keep the commandments of the Lord your God, with which I am charging you. You must observe them diligently, for this will show your wisdom and discernment to the peoples who, when they hear all these statutes, will say, "Surely this great nation is a wise and discerning people. For what other great nation has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is whenever we call to him? And what other great nation has statutes and ordinances as just as this entire law that I am setting before you today? But take care and watch yourselves closely so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from the book of James, chapter 1, verses 17 through 27. The letter of James was intended to provide first century Christians with instruction in godly behavior. Here, Christians are encouraged to listen carefully and to act on what they hear, especially by caring for those least able to care for themselves. Here begins the reading. Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and on going away immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion is that pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. The word of the Lord.
First week of school.
Yeah.
Good?
Yeah.
Got some good friends?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Now you know the whole routine?
Yeah.
Good. Good. All right. So, give you each one of these. Do you guys know what this is? Sorry.
Hand sanitizer.
Hand sanitizer. Why would you use hand sanitizer?
So you don't have
germs, right? Why don't you want germs on your hands? You can get you sick, right? Yeah, so today's gospel lesson is kind of a weird one. It doesn't really make sense, I think, not just to kids. I bet most adults are going to be kind of confused as to what Jesus is talking about on this one. So, some of Jesus's kind of opponents, people who questioned what Jesus was about, were called the Pharisees. Not all Pharisees, but some of the Pharisees. And the Pharisees were saying, you know what? Your disciples don't wash their hands the right way. Because in Jesus's day, did they have refrigerators? Nope. They didn't have refrigerators. They didn't have a lot of our medicines we have. They didn't have a lot of things we have. So it was really, really easy to get sick from food. And so God gave the Jewish people lots and lots of rules about how they were going to make food, what food they were going to eat, how they were going to wash their hands, how they were going to wash their food, all sorts of stuff. And it might seem silly to us, but it was, I think, God's way of taking care of God's people so they wouldn't get sick from food or from germs. But Jesus' opponents were saying, your disciples don't wash their hands the right way. And Jesus responded, not so much saying that it's not important to wash your hands, because it is, but he said, what's more important than what goes in your mouth, like the food you eat, germs, that kind of stuff, what's more important than that is what comes out of your mouth. What kinds of things come out of your mouth? The germs would come out when you sneeze. You're supposed to cover your mouth. You're very good. Yep, when you cough, very good. You can tell you're a nurse's daughter. You know this. You know how important this is. What other things come out of our mouths?
I don't know.
You don't know? Bad stuff. But what else? What about, like, words? Do words come out of our mouth?
Yeah?
Do things we say come out of our mouth?
No.
Well, yeah, some of the things we say, maybe, you know, they might... they come out. Do we say good things sometimes?
Yeah.
Do we say bad things sometimes?
Yeah.
So Jesus is saying in today's lesson, which is very, very confusing, that just as it's important to wash your hands, it's even more important to think about what comes out of our mouth. When we say mean things or judgmental things or angry things, that's just as important as what we put in our mouth and how we wash our hands. So this week, a goal for all of us, because you know what? Let's turn around. Adults, do you ever struggle with what comes out of your mouth? Right? I sure do. Yep, we all do. This is something we all have to work really, really hard on, is to think about how can the words that come out of my mouth show other people that they are loved and they are valued by God and that God is always with them. So I want you to take your hand sanitizer, and every time you do wash your hand, think about this lesson and think about that it's not just important to think about what goes in our mouth, but also what comes out of it. So can you fold your hand and I'll pray for you? Gracious God, I thank you for these ladies and I ask that you would bless them at school this week and keep them safe and surround them with all good things. Bless their family. Lord, I ask that you would help all of us to show your love and care by what we say and by what we do. Help us to think twice about what comes out of our mouth. In your holy and precious name, amen. Thank you for coming up. Have a good another week of...
Gospel according to St. Mark. Mark's gospel depicts Jesus as challenging traditional ways in which religious people determine what is pure or impure. For Jesus, the observance of religious practices cannot become a substitute for godly words or deeds that spring from a faithful heart. Here begins the gospel. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus,
They noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all of the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the traditions of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesies rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition.'" Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside of a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All of these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father. There is a joke that goes around amongst Lutheran pastors that so-and-so Lutheran pastor never did a good work for fear that he or she might be accused of work righteousness. Now, truthfully, if you're not a Lutheran pastor, it's probably not a very good joke. It really just means that someone is considered or considers himself or herself to be very grounded theologically in the Lutheran tradition, and so they avoid work righteousness types of theology. So what does work righteousness mean, you might be asking? Well, now I'm going to proceed and completely kill the joke by fully explaining it. So here it is. So one of Martin Luther's fundamental beliefs was that all of us are saved by grace through faith and not by our good works. He truly believed that none of us are fully capable of change at all, enough to be considered a good person. But rather, no matter how much we try and no matter how much we might change, we are all through and through sinners no matter what. Instead, we are only saved by God's righteousness, which is poured out on us because God loves us. That's it. Martin Luther was clear that good works are in fact necessary, but it's not God who needs our good works. Rather, the people around us need our good works, and therefore we should always try to do good works simply because the people around us need our good works. However, according to Luther, we always must be clear that we are not saved by, or really even better people, by our actions, by our good works. Now, in seminary, this distinction, that our works are good but not sufficient to merit salvation, as a Lutheran pastor, this distinction is drilled into our heads constantly. When preaching, many of us Lutheran pastors preach what we call law and gospel type sermons. That is, we'll start off a sermon and we'll discuss all of the ways that we all fail and we don't live up to what God calls us to do. That's the law. It kills us. And then we follow up with the promise that God loves us, provides for us, and saves us anyhow. That's the gospel. That's the good news. You can listen each and every week and try to identify the law and the gospel of what I preach. The biblical text or the personal stories or the illustrating stories might change from week to week, but the same formula, if you will, always is the same, law and gospel. Because of the Lutheran emphasis that we are saved by grace and not by works. Well, because of that emphasis, Martin Luther was very leery of the book of James in the Bible. Therefore, you'd be hard-pressed to find a Lutheran pastor who would name the book of James as even one of their top five books of the Bible. And we do have top books of pastors. It's nerdy, but it's true. So Dr. James L. Boyce says the following about the book of James. Martin Luther once characterized the letter of James as an epistle of straw. As a result, Lutherans have not always appreciated the message of the book of James. What was the basis of Luther's comment? He believed that Jesus Christ and his cross and resurrection were the heart of Scripture. For Luther, then, the two brief references to Jesus Christ in the book of James and its lack of any reference to the death and resurrection didn't offer what he felt was centrally the Christian message when James is considered and compared to other parts of the New Testament. Though I revere many of Luther's contributions to the world and religion in particular, I don't really think he fully got it right, though, about the book of James. And I think this dialogue is important for all of us to kind of mull around in our heads and consider. We all, whether we admit it or not, have books of the Bible that we resonate with. We have books of the Bible that we emphasize. We have certain verses and passages that we are quick to note and to adhere to, and others we forget about, we play down as lessers, we don't consider them as much. In short, we all have a canon within a canon, a group of Bible passages, a group of books that we consider to be the most important, and others we consider to be less. We all do this. Well, the book of James isn't my favorite book either, but I do think it has a really important message to tell all of us. The book of James is a good reminder that through Christ, not our own power, but through Christ's power, I would say that we really do have the power to do challenging things, including living loving, compassionate lives that don't simply mirror the ways of evil of the world. The book of James is a reminder that our very lives preach messages to the world around us. Many people nowadays might never enter a church building, but hopefully they will feel God's love, receive daily provision, and witness grace through the lives of us, those who profess to follow Jesus. And our lives are better even if we try, and even if we fail miserably, but even if we try to follow Jesus' path of love and light, I believe our lives are instrumentally better. And that is the message of the book of James. The book of James was intended for all of Jesus' followers. That is, unlike other letters, it wasn't a letter to a specific church or a specific community, but it was intended that all Christians would hear this message. Jesus' own Sermon on the Mount and the book of Proverbs alike were both influential in the writing of this book. The author of the book of James is calling followers to be truly wise by living according to Jesus' summary of the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. And Jesus' summary of the Torah is this: love God, love your neighbor as yourself. The book of James includes 12 teachings about how we are to practice this wholehearted devotion to Jesus, how we are both to love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. That is, the book of James illustrates how we should love God and our neighbors in daily life. For instance, in the book of James, James calls out our human tendency to admire and welcome and serve those who are of high status and have significant means, while ignoring those who are poor, marginalized, or down and out in some way. James notes that we do this because we praise and admire those we think will elevate or benefit us. But that is not what Christ calls us to do. The book of James highlights that if we say we love the poor and the outcast, our faith should compel us to act accordingly. The book of James continues on to highlight how we will harm and degrade people in one note with our words and then quickly turn around and praise God, forgetting the harm that we just caused our neighbors. The author of this book of the Bible points out the hypocrisy or incongruence between what we say about our neighbors and what we say about God. Likewise, the book of James makes the case that our words show our true character, and that in the kingdom of God, things like wealth and status should no longer distinguish or divide us. The book talks about our ability to distort truth to our own advantage and to distort truth so it fits our own narratives. The book of James also includes the harsh note that financial wealth does not last forever. In fact, the whole book goes on to say that one day wealth itself will rot. This book says as Christians we are to live with patience and hope that one day Jesus will return and set all things straight. As Christians, we should live in faith and live in prayer in the meantime. As Christians, we should trust and keep the faith that in the middle of trials and sufferings, we know that God will produce endurance, maturity, and faith. This whole letter is an encouragement that God gives us wisdom so that we can live in wholeness. So if you have not read the book of James, which I'm guessing most of us Lutherans have not, I encourage you to go home and read it. It is a short reminder, a short book, but one that I think has a powerful call to witness for all of us. It encourages us to trust that God will provide for us despite whatever we face. We are called in the book of James not to just be people who hear God's word, but to be people who do God's word. I can see why Martin Luther didn't like the book of James. For me, I don't like it because I don't always live up to what is calling me to do. Remember that law I was talking about? Well, all of those shoulds in the book of James, all of those things we're called to do, well, they kind of feel like weighty laws to me. But as often it is in life, just because I don't like being reminded how often I don't live up to what I'm called to do, just because I don't like hearing what James has to offer, it doesn't mean that I don't have to hear it. It doesn't mean that I don't need to hear it. Because while trying to live in this loving, gracious manner that reflects God's will is hard for me, it is life-giving for the people around me. When I live in that way, it can bring the people around me peace and hope and joy. And eventually, when those patterns form loving habits, they can bring me peace and hope and joy too. As we start off another school year full of church programs and school activities and all of the like, I encourage all of us to think about the words we hear in James today. Bring your bulletin home and think about it. As it says, how can I be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger? How can I be a doer of the word and not merely a hearer of the word? How can I bridle my tongue? How can I care for those in distress? Our churches will not be changed if we only aim to get butts in the pews, as we often say. If our only goal is to find peace and solace for ourselves while we're here, our churches will not change. Our church will only be changed if we hear the challenging and hopeful messages of the Bible and allow them to take root in our hearts and in our minds, and allow those messages to compel us to change. Our families will not be changed if we only state that these are the values we have in church, and that we hear them, but we don't live them out. Our families will be changed if God's callings to us change our thoughts, our words, and our deeds. Well, the good news is that, as the author of James notes, God empowers us and shows us how to live good lives, as impossible as that might feel some days. The good news is that, as Luther would be quick to point out, the book of James is not the only book of the Bible we get. No, verse after verse and story after story of the Bible reminds us that even when we fail every single call that we have from God, even when we fail everything we're supposed to do, even when we don't follow a single message of what we are called to do in the book of James, Jesus dies and saves us anyway. And that, at the end of the day, is the hope that sustains us. And when we are so deeply and profoundly changed by that hope, what other response makes sense than to go out and try to follow Christ in thought, word, and deed. May Christ strengthen us and guide us so that we might truly follow him each day. Amen. We continue with O God of every nation.
Stand as you are able and join me in the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Drawn together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray with confidence for the church, God's good creation, and all who are in need. Gracious God, we ask that you be with the Blair family today. We ask that you would give them health and healing. Merciful God, God of every generation, give the church a sense of purpose and belonging. Sustain and build up leaders and lay people as we accompany one another in our life with Christ. Merciful God, on this Labor Day weekend, we remember and give thanks for all who have fought for workers' rights throughout the world. Continue to improve working conditions and establish fair wages so that all people may thrive. Merciful God,
Gracious God, we pray for our travels today, that you would give us safe travels to the Rich's home. Be with us and help us to do this work well and quickly. We ask that you would continue to bless the Richards family in this time of transition. We ask for health and healing for Mark. We ask for guidance and courage for Brenda. We ask that you would watch over them. Merciful God, gracious God, we pray for the Marsh family as they travel to celebrate Sandra's life well lived. We ask that you would honor that time together and that you would be with them as they mourn her passing. Merciful God, gracious God, we give you thanks for a good start to the school year. We pray for schools that will be starting this week. We ask that you would keep all of our students and our staff and our teachers safe this year. Merciful God,
Lord, we pray for members struggling with their health, relationships, or well-being. Bring your healing to them. Sustain and guide those who care for them. Jean Black, Dennis, Kathy Summers, Kathy Crone, Glenda, Val, Zach, Gail, Joanne, Charlene, Marilyn, Julie, and Denny. God, be with your members in assisted living and care facilities. In this time of difficult staffing situations, provide for them. Surround those who feel lonely or forgotten with your care. We especially remember Doris, Diane, Betty, Pearl, Joan, and Jean Bender. Lord, we pray for our family members and friends who are struggling near and far. Heal and guide them. We especially remember Vicky, Darlene, Debbie, Rick, Kelly, Megan, Stan, Mark, Joe, Butch, Josh, Tom, and Brad, our servicemen and women, and Love, Inc.
Merciful God, we entrust these and all our prayers to you, Holy God, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. As a sign of that peace, let us share the peace with those around us. You may be seated. We continue worshiping God with our tithes and offerings. As a part of our Cultivating Generous Congregations program, we continue to lift up a moment in the life of our congregations to remind ourselves what our money makes happen here. Today, I want to give a word of thanks to all of the volunteers who fill in for the office whenever Natalie is gone. She took a well-deserved week of vacation this week, and I am so thankful for all of you who serve in that way so that I can continue to do my normally scheduled things instead of being in the office. So thank you so much for your service.
Thank you.
the Lord and fill to the brim our cup of blessing. Gather the harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of life. Gather the hopes and the dreams of all, unite them with the prayers we offer now. Grace our table with your presence and give us a foretaste of the feast to come.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all of the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God above, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, in the highest.
In the night in which he's betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. You may be seated. All are welcome to commune with us. The wine is purple, the juice is white. There is gluten-free available. Parents, help me know if your kids receive communion or if they receive a blessing. All are welcome. The body of Christ is given for you.
Thank you.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We continue to send communion. Thanks to the Lofensians for their good work in this service. And we continue to send communion. If you know of someone who is not receiving communion, who should be, please let us know. Gracious God, in this meal, you have drawn us to your heart and nourished us at your table with food and drink, the body and blood of Christ. Now send us forth to be your people in the world and to proclaim your truth this day and evermore. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gracious God, loving all your family with a mother's tender care, as you sent the angel to feed Elijah with heavenly bread, assist those who set forth to share your word and sacrament with those who are sick, homebound, and in prison. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those who will receive this sacrament, and give us all the comfort of your abiding presence through the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand as we sing our final hymn, Go Sent Forth by God's Blessing.